It is the highest grossing romantic comedy of all time. Yep, My Big Fat Greek Wedding. That is a fact. And it all began as a one-woman play by this woman, Nia Vardalos. And some 14 years later, she's back with a sequel, but the reason for that delay might not necessarily be what you expect. Vardalos felt like she couldn't play a convincing on-screen mother until she was one. The problem was that after years of trying, she couldn't conceive. However, all of that changed when she turned to adoption.
I hid the truth of why I didn't want to do the sequel. I just quietly said, no, that's okay, and I did other movies. And I mean, I couldn't even pour creamer into a coffee at a diner without someone right up next to me going, where's the sequel? And I was like, oh my God, okay. And you know, the truth is, I wasn't a mom. And how do I say that? You know, how do I say I'm in a private situation? It all changed on my daughter's first day of kindergarten. I realized, oh, well, I have become my own suffocating Greek mother, now haven't I? And that's what I wrote about. Okay! Get the door! Go! No, don't get the door! Get the door! Just go over there! Wait! What am I doing?
You wrote this amazing book about your experience of adopting, and it was a very sort of fast process when it actually happened. You had 14 hours to prepare for your daughter to arrive after a long wait of trying to get pregnant and trying to adopt. When you have that 14 hours and then you see her for the first time, and now, of course, she's a part of your life, what goes through your head when you first met her?
I'm not equipped.
What did you do in the 14 hours, though? Like, how do you go? Because most people have 9 months to kind of prepare for it.
Because my nieces and nephews had slept over for years, everyone comes to visit. You know, there's no such thing as a hotel in an immigrant family. No, everyone sleeps over. We had blow-up beds. We had SpongeBob sheets. You know, so we just got the guest room ready for her. And then, you know, bing bong, 14 hours later, she just walked in her front door, and I was an instant mom.
Before you started going into adopting, if you could tell yourself anything about the process that you kind of wish you'd known, what would you tell yourself?
I would tell myself that it's your God-given right to have a biological child, so try everything that you can if that's what you want. And if that's not what you do want, there's another world out there. And it's the most gratifying experience because I think that My Big Fat Greek Wedding, one, as it shall be known from now on, I think it happened to me because I was supposed to go through all this and find my daughter and become very vocal about adoption. Just a little thing, because when I turned to adoption, I actually was slightly shamed to find a whole community of people who turned to adoption as the first option for expanding their families. And I thought, I have to write about these beautiful people.
Why do you think more people don't go to it as a first option?
Because the information isn't out there, and that's why the back of my book is how to adopt from all over the world, because it's information that I was looking for.
The wedding is on! Pick a category, report to me. I'm in charge.
Ashley, Thea, you're not.
Yes, it's best.
No,
it's what everyone wants, dear.
So much of your work and your life is in your work, and it's very confessional in a way. But how do you navigate that line between what is for public consumption and what is just for me?
It's a hard line, it really is. I'm very careful about what's public and what isn't, even though I've written a book about our lives.
It blows the lines, doesn't it?
It does. And I my daughter will never be photographed on a red carpet. She has a very normal life, and we just make sure to protect her privacy. But I'll tell you something, the paparazzi's not that interested in me. You know, I've walked right by them at the Grove in Los Angeles, and they just look at me like, she's not divorced. She hasn't adopted 17 kids from Africa. Who cares?
Did you invite the family?
I told my ma.
I was talking about this with my co-host because she's Arabic and I'm half Indian, and we were talking about the original My Big Fat Greek Wedding, about how even though it's very specifically Greek, it's kind of everyone, like that whole thing, like big families. And did you have a sense back then that it would be so universal?
No, because I just thought I wrote a movie about my family. And you're telling me now that you see your family in it, and that's the ultimate compliment for me. But don't you find this odd thing afterwards that we all feel like we're cousins? I always write from my own family, and my actual whole family showed up. There are several pictures from on set where you can't tell who plays my dad and who is my dad. So it was really great, but I keep saying that I believe the immigrant experience is the American experience, and the Australian experience, and the UK experience. Immigrants make the world go round.
I'm sure there's like three of them in this room right now.
That's right, yeah.
One of the other things that not many people know about you is that once upon a time, you were in Return of the Jedi the radio play.
I was.
What did you play?
Oh my God, I think I played a robot. I'm not sure, yes, yeah. I've done all sorts of weird things, like I try to donate as much of my time as possible, so I voiced Terminator for the blind.
Were you Sarah Connor or were you the Terminator?
I was all the characters, like I explained what was happening in each of the, you know, I like to talk.
I'm not gonna let you go without hearing your Arnold Schwarzenegger impression though.
Yeah.
Can you still do it?
I like the nanny.
Wait, what?
Neva Dallas, thank you so much.
Thank you.
We are all great.
We are, thank you.